Welcome to another message from Citizen Heights. We are located in the nation's capital, where our heart is to inspire hope, remove limitations, and help you experience God's possible for your life. Join Pastors Michael and Heather Giroux in their passion to help you live your best life. We hope you enjoy today's encouraging and uplifting message.
Love and wonders why. Citizen Heights, how are you today? Merry Christmas. Turn to your neighbor and tell him Merry Christmas. We're going to get you in the Christmas spirit today, and it's going to be a great day in church, whether you're joining us online or whether you're right here in the room. It's going to be a special day. In a few moments, you're going to hear some more musical specials. How about that opener? Pretty amazing, huh? And so some more Christmas music to get you in the mood. We're also going to have a message from the Bible. How many love the Bible around here? Absolutely. And then afterwards, we're going to have Santa Claus, gifts for every child, age toddler through fifth grade. Everybody gets a gift, a cookie, Christmas cookie reception. It's going to be a great day. And so if you can just help me right now while we get a few things ready, all of our regulars know what I'm about to do. This yellow card is our connection card. And so if you're a guest with us today, this really helps us make the introduction formal and official to say thanks for coming to church. So if you give us a good email address on this form, you can fill out as much as you like or as little, but if you give us a good email address, we'll send you a thank you for coming to church. We'll tell you how you can get involved at Citizen Heights, and you can just drop this in the offering in a few moments, and it's going to be a great day. And if you fill this out, we have a free gift for you. You can drop it in the offering and then just go down to the Welcome Center downstairs during the Christmas cookie reception and say, I filled out that card. I'm here for my free gift. They'll put a book in your hand just for coming to church to say thank you because it's Christmas, right? And we want you to have something to take with you to say that Citizen Heights is a place where you can find family and you can find a home. So are you ready for a great Christmas? This is called our Christmas Spectacular. We're kicking off the new year or the season, right? So why don't you go ahead and be seated right now, a little bit different, and enjoy the Citizen Heights Christmas Spectacular.
Oh, Given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatest of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness. From that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Come and see what God has done. What name could contain such a glory? In the cool breezes of Eden, brought from the infant earth, one arose, the voice of his creator speaking his identity to life. Adam, man. And as heaven waited short with breath, the creator spoke yet another, Eve, mother of all the living. So it was with Abraham, named in the promise as the father of nations. Peter, the rock upon which the church would stand. The name called to life the destiny within. The name set the stage for all that was to come. And unto us a child was born. And what name could contain his glory? For he was mighty God, as the universe gasped into being, flinging rays of light from his presence to pierce the void, to shatter the shadows to a tapestry of color. And he is mighty God, shattering our darkness, revealing our light, our truth in him. He was everlasting Father when orphaned Israel needed a father's touch. When we, with grief-stricken cheeks, need the embrace of one who never leaves. When we have lost our way to dark horizons, it is our everlasting Father who lights the way home. He is Prince of Peace. When, like Elijah, we need the still small voice in the turmoil's midst. When, like David, we need the melodies of his presence to soothe our troubled minds. He is sanctuary within our trials, shepherd guiding us to still waters. And yes, he is wonderful counselor. God who gives counsel in the chaos, crafting disorder into calm and failure into beauty. He is a voice for the voiceless. He is dignity for the stateless soul. It is he who raised up a lowly shepherd to become a king. He who took the fishermen of Galilee and made them leaders of history. It is the counselor who redeems our lost years, breaking chains that have kept dreams imprisoned and joy confined. The name reaches across eternity, exclaimed by the splendors of galaxies, sung by the passions of angels, roared in heaven's fervor, exalted in creation's unfettered rejoicing. What name could contain him? What title? What soul renowned? For this is our wonderful counselor. This is our mighty God. This is our everlasting Father, our Prince of Peace. What name could contain Emmanuel, God with us, Yahweh, the great I am? What name could contain the Word of Life, the Light of the World, the King of Kings, the Lord of all? We bow to the name that holds every other in its matchless worth. What name could contain such a glory? What name but Jesus? We cry Jesus. We cry holy is the name.
Come and behold him, born the Oh,
God, we serve a mighty God, don't we? The name that's above every other name, the name of Jesus. And when you read through the Bible and you see all the different when you read through the Bible, see all the names for God, you see all the angles and the reflections and the facets of his nature. See the goodness of God. You see the intentions of God. You see the ministry of Jesus to each and every one of us. And what a phenomenal reminder that we get built into our calendar, but something that God wants to build into the deep places of our lives, that he's the hope of the world. He's the living hope. Amen. And that God is with us, Emmanuel. We celebrate it at Christmas. We celebrate the reality that Jesus is with you. He's in this with you. Come on, you're not on journey and on mission and in the midst of life on your own. You know, I'm glad that we have community. I'm glad we have church. I'm glad we have the support that is around us. But if all we were was a collection of supportive relationships and friendships, it wouldn't be enough. Sometimes I think we lose the power and the strength of the gospel through the strength of the community. And it's like, yes, God gives you strength in community. But the reason there's strength in this community is because Jesus is the head of the church, the Bible tells us. He's the chief cornerstone. He's the thing on which we build and are built. And he's our hope, amen? So I hope today you find friendships and you go deeper in those you know and you make new relationships and friendships and all the things that church and community bring us, because not because it's just a collection of good people, because we know better. We're a collection of broken people. We're a collection of people with pasts. We're a collection of people who haven't figured it all out yet, but we've figured out this much. There's a name that's above every other name. There's a God who loves us, who sees us, who knows us. And all of history is defined and divided by his arrival to come get us. Amen. I hope you sense today that Christmas is more than holiday cheer. There's a spiritual reality to it that is in Jesus, him alone. And so I'm going to go ahead and ask you to be seated now and thank our team for what a phenomenal Christmas spectacular. Awesome. And how about that choir? I could get used to the choir. Every single week choir, like every week choir would be okay with us. We're going to transition for a moment now, and in a moment we're going to open the Bible. We're going to talk about the significance of Christmas. But before we do, I want to lead us in the giving. We have a moment right now where our hosts are going to come forward, and you can see on the screen three easy ways to give. And we love to give at Citizen Heights. Can I just be honest with you? Like we've discovered the joy of generosity. We've discovered the blessing of obedience and the goodness of God. So thank you for being a faithful church, because we're reaching out right now. We're doing a lot with Prison Fellowship, ministering to the lives and families of those who are incarcerated. We're doing Angel Tree. We're doing a couple other outreaches as well through the church. Your giving makes that possible. Your tithes and your offerings makes a difference. It changes lives. So thank you for being involved with that. And 2 Corinthians 9 tells us that God loves a cheerful giver. And Christmas is a powerful time, because it's an occasion where we sometimes accidentally discover the joy and the blessing of giving. It says God loves a cheerful giver. And I don't know about you, but that's a journey, isn't it? We kind of go from an obedient giver or an accidental giver. But suddenly you realize, and I've watched that in my own kids' lives over the years, when they're little, when they wake up and come tearing down the stairs, and when they were little, we'd have to roadblock it, stop them, say, we're doing a photo on the stairs. And they're just like presents, right? They just want to tear into those gifts. And that's all they can think about. Well, we stop them and we torture them on the stairs with a photo, a family photo. And but as the years have gone on, they make this journey from just, what did I get? And you see it where they're just kind of like, they're hovering around you afterwards saying, I can't wait for you to open. Matter of fact, they start teasing you weeks before, like we used to do to them. Like, you're not gonna believe what I got you. You're not gonna believe. I can't wait to see your face when you open. And that's a journey from, like, you know, when you're young, it's about what you get. Because that's just, you know, that's your wavelength. That's what you're able to kind of conjure. But as you mature in God, you realize there's a joy and a cheerfulness in giving. And that's why Jesus said, it's quoted in Acts 20, they quote Jesus, he said, it is more blessed to give than it is to receive. And that's a journey, isn't it? So church, thank you for taking that journey. Wherever you are in that journey, thank you for taking another step of faith today. It is more blessed to give than to receive. And there is a joy in giving. And God loves a cheerful giver. So let your gift today, as we get ready to give three easy ways, let it be something that you're doing not out of obligation. You know, I'm not the chief financial officer here at Citizen Heights. I'm just a shepherd who says this is what God's word says, and if we walk in this truth, it's going to open the windows of heaven over our lives in an amazing way. And so when we take a step into that truth, there's going to be a cheerfulness in your giving in a new way. Do you believe that today? We're going to go ahead while you prepare your gift. Remember, if you're a guest with us, fill out that connection card, drop it in the offering right now. We can't wait to see you downstairs at our welcome center in a few moments. But go ahead, let's give today as you direct your attention to church news.
Merry Christmas, Citizen Heights. Thank you for joining us today for our Christmas Spectacular. We've got some more Christmas fun planned just for you, so pull out your calendar and plan to come back and celebrate with us.
This Saturday, December 16th, at 6 p.m., we're hosting a special Blue Christmas experience here in Tenleytown. We know the holidays can be a difficult time of the year, but our hope is found in Jesus. If you'd like to honor someone you've lost, please send their name and photo to info@citizenheights.com.
Looking ahead to Christmas Eve, we have two special experiences for you. Join us on Sunday morning at 10 a.m. for our heartwarming Christmas celebration. And later that night at 6 p.m., experience the warmth of our family-style Christmas Eve candlelight experience.
We hope you've enjoyed our Christmas Spectacular. In a few moments after we dismiss, we hope you'll join us downstairs for our Christmas cookie reception and the chance to take photos with Santa. It's a festive way for us to wrap up our Sunday together. That's all for now, church. Merry Christmas.
All right. How are you doing, church? I came out the side door. How do you like that? Didn't see that coming. Well, welcome again, online campus. Let's welcome them as they join us wherever you are today. I'm glad you made time and you made the effort to join us. Give yourself a screen name, enter the chat, get involved with what God is saying. And here in this room, do you have your Bibles with you? We got Christmas cookie reception coming in a few moments. We got Santa downstairs. But we're going to take a moment right now because beyond the song and the melodies and the season and the sweaters and all the stuff that makes Christmas special, there is a historical reality and there's a spiritual significance to what we're discussing today. And so I'm going to invite you to turn with me to Isaiah chapter 9. And we're going to read from Isaiah 9, verse 6. And as you turn there, can I just give you a kind of like a highlight on the calendar for your Christmas season? Church, can I'm asking permission. I'm being polite. Can I just remind you this? Might want to pull out your phone, get your calendar. Is one of the things we do during the Christmas season that is very special to us, Heather and I really, really value an opportunity to do something we call the Blue Christmas Experience. And the Blue Christmas Experience is this Saturday at 6 p.m. And it's really for those in the Christmas season who the Christmas season is also a season of grief or a moment where you're really in remembrance of loss. So our Blue Christmas Experience gives us an opportunity to stand with you. To celebrate maybe a life loss or someone who's no longer with you or just something else that's going on in your life right now. And if you'd like to honor somebody that you've lost and share their name and share their photo, it'd be our joy to help you commemorate them, what they mean to you, and the significance of the season without them in your life. So you can email their photo, their name, any other information you would like us, if you would like us to include them in the Blue Christmas Experience, to our email. Our general email account is info@citizenheights.com, and that will help us honor them and commemorate that moment and be there in a significant way for people who, you know, it's not all cheery and bright. And some of it is reality of loss and the significance of that. So we want to be there for you, church, Saturday the 16th at 6 p.m. You're all invited, and I hope that that's a blessing to your life. Amen? Okay, we're turning to Isaiah chapter 9. Merry Christmas to you as you find your way there. The team will put this up for us in a moment. But I want us today to really focus on, again, just it's a historical, but it's a personal thing that we're discussing today. It's Jesus came to earth. Jesus' birth in a manger, yet at the same time, he's on a mission to save the world. And when we think world and globally, we think, oh, it's out there somewhere. It's big. It's expansive. It's beyond me. No, it's all about God getting to you. And it's a personal thing. So to help us, we're going to continue our series today entitled He Shall Be Called. And what we're doing is we're examining the names and the nature of Jesus as they have been revealed to us in the prophet Isaiah. And so you've heard a lot about it in all the songs today already. But let's go ahead and get a scriptural foundation for what we're discussing. Isaiah 9:6, team can put this up for you so you can read along. It says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." Can you say amen? "For unto us a child is born, and his name shall be called." And I love that video segment we had a moment ago. It said, what name could you give a God who is this able and yet at the same time this interested? What name could you give? And naming a baby is serious business. Can we agree? Naming a baby is, yeah, thank you. A baby just agreed with me over here. I think we can all agree, naming a baby is serious. It's not like naming a pet, right? Naming a pet is different. We've named our four children. They successfully all have names. But for obvious reasons, naming a pet is much easier. Now, I remember many years ago at a church that we had planted in 2006, a dear family in the church gave we had three sons at the time. They gave us three hamsters, one for each son. And they named their pets, and Caden named his, Incredibles had just come out, The Incredibles, and so Dash, you know, fast. Being fast when you're a little boy is very important. And so Caden named his Dash. Gavin was a lover of animals. He would literally shake anytime he got near an animal. He just wanted to touch animals, and he was very into animals. So he named his Fluffy, because he just wanted to cuddle it. And Owen, who was a bit of a rebel, he thought, what would be rebellious? What would be really, like, edgy? And so he named his hamster Bad the Runner. Put Bad right in the name, Bad the Runner. And, you know, it's easy to name pets, right? They don't grow up. They don't go to junior high. They don't get ridiculed for their names. You just name your pet whatever you want to name your pet. In fact, if you're getting a dog anytime soon, come see me. I have on my phone 57 dog names. I have a note in my notes section. 57 dog names. Just in case Heather lets me get a third, I am ready. I'm locked in. I got a lot of good dog names. But naming a pet is easy. And I remember years ago, we got a boxer. It was our second boxer. And this dog was beautiful. It's the third most beautiful dog I've ever owned. And like conformity-wise and its coat and it was brindle, just a beautiful boxer. And we named her Lucy. And that dog was one of it's the single most frustrating encounter I've ever had with an animal and might be the worst thing I've ever done in my life is getting that dog. I could not win with that dog. I could not train that dog. I couldn't tame it. It would get out of the house, and it would put like a 10-foot bubble. And everywhere I went, it was 10 foot away from me, barking at me and publicly shaming me in front of my neighbors. I couldn't get it to recall. I could not win with that dog. And it was so frustrating. I remember talking through my teeth to that dog so many times, and I thought, this isn't, you know. We named her Lucy, short for Lucille. But after a while, I realized that wasn't short for Lucille. It's short for Lucifer. Like, this dog is the instrument of the devil in my life, and it vexed me. But when we named our kids, we were intentional, right? Like all parents. We wanted there to be a significance. We wanted there to be meaning to their names. We wanted our sons' names to mean something because the meaning mattered. And in the Bible, a name reveals nature. You know, you heard on that video montage, the name reveals a destiny. And it's true. Oh my goodness, that's twice today. The name of Jesus and the meaning that mattered, we see in the names of Jesus, it tells us about his nature and it tells us about his ministry. And no prophet had more to say about this topic than Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, we just read, the names of God, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And today I want to consider the name Prince of Peace. Are you with me? We're told that Jesus, the Messiah, who would rule and reign over all the earth, is Prince of Peace. And this is good news. In fact, this is great news that he is Prince of Peace, because we live in a world of turmoil. We live in a world of division and wars and strife and anxiety. We live in a world of enmity and hatred, and we live in a world that where there's hurt and there's pain and there's sorrow and there's all this tension, right? And in the midst of that, it says that Jesus will be the Prince of Peace. He brings peace to the hearts of all who trust him. So I have a question for you today. Do you trust Jesus to be your Prince of Peace today? See, the name Prince of Peace, you have to ask what's in this name. And I want to take a look at the Hebrew. Are you giving me water? I do have allergies. I'm going to blame it on allergies. But it could be like post late onset adult puberty. Adult onset, I don't know. That's a thing. But let's talk about Prince of Peace, because this is a Hebrew word. This is a Hebrew name that's packed with meaning, okay? So I want to put this up so you can see it. The name in Hebrew is Shar Shalom. Looks like Sar, but it's Shar Shalom. And Shar means prince, captain, chief, ruler, governor, keeper. Right? He's the commander, the principal, the general, the lord, the master. Okay, so this is a royal title. He's the prince. And this word, the word Sar, it's a parent root of a word that literally means to turn the head. It's where Sarah gets her name from, S-A-R, to turn the head. The root of her name, because she turned the head of Abraham and he noticed her. So this has got an attractional element to it. Like, it turned my head because I was attracted to something different that I was seeing. I noticed you, and I'm changing my course because of you. You're a commander, you're a general, you're a leader, but there's something about you that I want to go where you're going. So he's the prince, but it says of peace, shalom. That's where he's going. You could ask yourself, where is God taking me? What's his intention for me? What are the coordinates that God, it says that his word and his lamp is a light unto my path. And so if my feet and my life and my direction and my decisions are tracking in and following Jesus, remember what Jesus said when he met his disciples, follow me, follow me, follow me. I'll be the prince, the leader, the commander, and I'm going somewhere. Where are you going, God? And where are you taking me? Shalom. It means peace, wholeness, completeness, finished work, perfection, safety, and wellness. That's where God is taking you. So what does it mean that Jesus is the Prince of Peace? It tells us something incredible about the character of God and the ministry of Jesus and the nature of Jesus. He's turning our heads. We're seeing something that we don't see in the world. We think, well, if I get a job or promotion or pay increase, that will bring me peace. But it doesn't, because more money, it just happens that way. And you think, I thought money would give me peace, but it doesn't. And you think, well, if I find the mate that I've been... And I can tell you, there are peaceful moments and there are sharpening moments, right? And you think, well, if I just attain this or acquire that or somehow get beyond or over this other challenge, that peace is on the other side of the next horizon, but it's elusive. But he's the God who turns our heads. We notice who he is, where he's going, and we start to change our course to follow him. He's the Prince of Peace. And he brings true peace, not like this counterfeit calm, right? Calm is not peace. Inactivity is not peace, right? So let's look at very quickly this morning two powerful attributes of true peace. How many want true peace today? The peace that only God can give, the Prince of Peace. Number one, true peace attribute. True peace is not next, it's right now. So I love this. When we look at it, the scriptures, we think of, well, there's a lot that God promises that we hope is for now, but we know ultimately we'll get in eternity. And so we kind of can just say, well, if I'm not physically healed now, I know I'll be fully restored in eternity. And if I don't get justice now, I know I'll ultimately get perfect justice in eternity. And there's this sense of, well, even if it's not meant for now, God will give it to me later. But peace is not a next promise. It's a now promise. John 14:27. Look at this. We'll put this up so you can consider it with me. It says, but before his death, he told his followers, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. It's not a promise of a potential maybe. It's something delivered right now. Something we can have and take hold of right now. And he says, not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. It builds right into the delivery of peace, that peace is at its apex when you are in a place of trouble, when you're in a place where there's fear. He says, I'm giving you something because there's going to be moments of life where you need a peace that passes understanding. You need an abiding peace that helps you and brings wholeness to you and brings a wellness to you in the midst of troubled times. So it's not a promise of potential peace. It's the reality of a present tense peace right here. See, in Galatians 5:22, we see peace is one of the fruits of the Spirit. It's one of the fruits of the Spirit. That means, you know, a fruit is something that just grows on the tree because the tree is what it is. An apple tree grows. Okay, well, we'll try that again because this. An apple tree grows. A pear tree grows. A carrot tree grows. There's no carrot trees. But it grows the fruit by virtue of what it is. And if the soil is good and the irrigation is present, there will be fruit. And in the life of those who trust in God, when you're trusting God, things start growing on your life that you're not striving to attain, and you're not strategizing to try to manufacture. You're not scheming on how can I get more of this and more of that. It just starts growing on the branches of your life. Galatians 5:22 says peace is growing in your life. It's growing. It just grows a bit more each day. You walk in the Spirit. I'm trusting in God, right? Trust God. The peace gets a little bit bigger. I worship God. The peace gets a little bit bigger. I read something and discover something about God's word, and I start to not just hear it but obey it. The peace gets a little bit bigger. I see something I want, but I feel something in my spirit say, not now, not this. God has something better, but I really, really want it. And you go, God, not what I want, what you want. And I resist and I follow the still small voice of the Holy Spirit. The peace gets a little bit bigger. We can walk with God's peace at all times. Say amen. We can walk with peace in every chapter of life, even the tough ones, especially the tough ones. Do you believe me? We all know John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world, right? But do you know 2 Thessalonians 3:16? 2 Thessalonians 3:16 is the proof text for what I just said. We can have peace at all times. Look at it with me. It says, now may the Lord of peace, another name of Jesus, he's the Lord of peace, may he himself give you peace at all times in every way. In all times, in every way. True peace is not next. True peace is now. And we take hold of peace. How do we do it? Number two, second attribute of peace is this. True peace is not an absence of turmoil. It's the presence of Jesus. Listen, if I told you the secret to a peace-filled life is to settle all accounts, negotiate surrenders and terms where there's no more conflict, get to a place where there's no more adversarial or chaos or just moments where you feel the tension of lives out of sync or relationships. If I told you just get everything in order and you'll have peace, listen, that's not true peace. True peace is not just the absence of turmoil. It's not negotiating peace treaties with all the things that you think are resisting you. It's the presence of Jesus. That's true peace. John 16:33 says, I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you'll have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. He says, listen, I'm the commander. I'm the prince. I'm the governor. I'm the general. And I've overcome the world. And I'm giving you a peace. And guess where your peace comes from? It's my very presence. In me, you will have peace. In me. Jesus isn't just, more peaceful than you. Jesus is peace for you. He's not just the Prince of Peace. Look at him. He's got the sash of peace. He's overcome the world, and he's enjoying his peace. No, he doesn't just have more peace than you. He is peace for you. Peace does not start with others. It starts with God. Peace does not start, with the absence of, it's a pretty good time in life, and, I'm going pretty good right now, and things are working out for me. I feel a lot of peace. It's like, well, that's not the peace God described. I mean, I'm glad what you're enjoying right now is just blessing. Good for you. But peace pays the bills when things are going wrong. Peace pays the bills when the world is on its head. Peace comes through. And that's why when we say, well, how do I access this peace? It's not a commodity. It's a person. It's the person of Jesus. Peace does not start with others. It starts with your relationship with God. And some of us lose our peace sometimes, and we go, where do I start? Where do I begin? Get back to the cross. Get back to the cross. Get back to the place where you say, Jesus, I'm trusting you with my life. I don't just trust you with my sins that you forgive. I trust you with my kids who I'm believing for. I trust you with the financial provisions of my life. I trust you with my marriage. I trust you with my mental health. I trust you with my physical health. I trust you, God, in a deep way. And when we come and we surrender and cast all of our cares on him, that is an act of trust. That's an act that says the presence of Jesus, as I trust God, the peace of God. Look at Romans 5:1. Paul developed the theme of peace quite a bit in Romans. And in chapter 5, verse 1, he said, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. It happens by faith, amen? Through Jesus, we find peace. That's why in Ephesians 2:14, Paul identifies Jesus himself is our peace. I'm not going to find peace apart from Jesus. That's why worship is such this extraordinary transaction. It's this moment where we cast all our cares, all our chaos, all our concerns, and we say, God, you're so big. Why am I stressing? God, you're eternal. And the accounts that are not paid here on earth will get paid in eternity. God, you know me, you see me, and you know what I'm going through. And in the midst of all of that, I can walk with a sense of wholeness. in a sense of health, in a sense of blessing, in a sense of favor, in a sense of God is with me. Colossians 1:20. End with this and maybe one more text. But look at this, Colossians 1:20. Let this stir your faith, because the Bible says faith comes by hearing God's word. And I think one of the great, you know, synonyms, if you will, of the word faith, if you're like, well, what is faith? Faith comes by hearing God. Faith, one of the great synonyms is trust. Trusting God comes from hearing his word. So what does he have to say? Colossians 1:20. And through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood that was shed on the cross. That's where peace comes from. The cross. Think about that. Jesus was providing peace to the people he had created who are now crucifying him. And he's purchasing not only their forgiveness, not only their eternal salvation, but in the here and now, in the presence of Jesus, a peace, a true peace. Prince of Peace. Think about how good God is. Consider how different the kings and the rulers of this world, and we go through them and think, well, this was a great commander, and this was a great general, and this was a great king or president. And many of their reigns depended upon a bloody conquest, but not Jesus. His reign and rule was initiated by a bloody sacrifice. Not the blood of his forces and his minions and his underlings, but his own blood. His reign was established. That's where we find peace. He did not wield a sword. He bore a cross. That's where I find peace, is knowing who Jesus is and what he did for me. He did not shed the blood of others. He shed his own blood. This is a prince, this is a commander, this is a general who's turning our heads, and it's attractional, and it's really just, it's so different than anything we've seen, that we would follow a God who says, I'm taking you somewhere. I'm taking you, the ministry of Jesus and the nature of God is to take you towards peace, to take you on a journey of wholeness and restoration. Amen. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, the Bible tells us. Do you believe that? You know, we sang that earlier. We'll praise his name forever. The name of God, one of the names, Prince of Peace, the name that brings peace. Not a peace that was bought and sold by soldiers, but a peace bought and paid for by his perfect son. That's what we're celebrating today. Amen. It's the peace that passes understanding. It's the peace that can get you through the tough moments in life. It's a peace we can have now in life. It's a peace that can be with you at all times and every way. Come on, can you say amen? And it's the Bible says it's a peace that can rule your heart when all hell is breaking loose. That's the peace that God in Christ gave us. And as Isaiah pronounces, it's a peace born out of trust. Can I give you one last verse? You keep him, this is Isaiah. He knows a little bit about peace. He continues to speak about who Jesus says, you keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. How do you find the peace of God? He says, there's a perfect peace. There's a complete peace. It's a true peace. It's not a counterfeit peace. It's not a peace that's got jurisdictional limits. It's not a peace that's on a timer and it's ticking down. It's a peace that's durable. It's a peace that's supernatural. And how do we walk and step into this peace? Whose mind is stayed on him and trusts in him. Come on, today's a great day to take another step and say, God, I'm going to trust you with this. I'm going to trust you with this diagnosis. I'm going to trust you with this loved one. I'm going to trust you with my children. I'm going to trust you with this new business. God, I'm going to trust you like I've never trusted you before. And in that, we find peace. Amen. Would you close your eyes with me right now? Father, we thank you that you are our peace. You don't just give us peace. You don't just direct us to peace. But you are our peace. You are our shalom. You're our strong tower that we run into. And we find safety, and we find strength, and we find wholeness. God, forgive us for being those who run to other things. Our heads have been turned by other offers. Our heads have been turned by other coping mechanisms. And maybe we've chosen fear, and maybe we've chosen anxiety, and maybe we've chosen to fret or to regret or to rehearse or to become embittered and all the different ways that our heads have been turned. But God, we pray today the Prince of Peace would turn our heads, that where you're taking us is a place of peace. It's a place of restoration. It's a place of blessing and completeness. And with every eye closed, we want to give this moment right now to Jesus. The Bible says he's the name above all names, and every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. Ultimately, not just everybody in this room and everybody listening, not just our crowd, but the whole world of all eternity. The Bible says every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. It means that there will be a reality that settles upon each one of us, that at some point we recognize Jesus is the King of Kings. Jesus is the Lord of Lords. But we have an opportunity today to make that decision, not in hindsight when it's too late, but in this moment when there's so much life to be lived, a life lived for God, a life lived in his peace, a life lived watching him be the wonderful counselor who navigates you through your past and into your God-given future. A mighty God who can do anything. An eternal Father who nurtures and loves and cares for you. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. But we want to do it on this side of eternity where we can walk with God. And it's a decision of relationship, not a decision and a recognition of regret when it's too late. And I want to give you an opportunity right now. I'm going to count to three. And when I hit three, I'm going to invite you to lift your hand. And by lifting your hand, you're saying, I need to trust in Jesus. Maybe there's things you need to trust God for in your life, but you know in your heart of hearts, you have not trusted him with your salvation. The Bible says all have sinned and fall short of God's glory, but that Christ came and paid a price you could never pay, so that you could live in forgiveness and in blessing of relationship with him. On the count of three, you're going to lift your hand, and by lifting it, you're saying, I need Jesus in my life. I'm going to trust God that I don't have to work for his forgiveness. I can just receive his forgiveness by faith. Are you ready? One, don't wait. Today is a day of new beginnings. Two, he loves you right where you are, but he loves you too much to leave you there. He's turning your head, and he's going to take you into the goodness and the favor of God. Are you ready? One, two, three, hands in the air. Say, yeah, that's me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I got you. Thank you. Thank you. Might be the first time you've ever prayed this prayer, or it might be a recommitment moment, because you know in your heart of hearts, you need to trust in Jesus. Praise God. You can put your hands down. Maybe you didn't feel comfortable lifting your hand, but you know this is for you, so you're going to pray this prayer with us nice and loud all together. Dear Jesus, I give you my heart because you first gave me your life. In surrender and in sacrifice and in exchange for my life. Say this boldly. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I need you. Now, say this. I believe in Jesus, that he died on the cross, that he rose again, and that I'm saved by his grace. It's his gift to me. I don't have to work for it. I just receive it by faith in Jesus' name. Now declare this boldly. I am a Christian. By God's grace, I'm saved. In Jesus' name, Amen. Amen. Come on, can we rejoice with those who just prayed that prayer? God is good. God has great things for you. Man, we're excited for you today. In a few moments, as you know, we'll conclude. We'll sing one more song. We'll get you on your way. Christmas cookies are ready. Santa's warming up. Gifts for the kids. But before we do anything else, if you just prayed that prayer, it's the beginning of a new day for you. Amen? And can I just give you three pro tips on what to do next? The first thing is simply this. Tell someone. Speak out. Go ahead and share that you made that decision with someone else. You can tell someone who brought you today. You can tell somebody who's been praying for you for years. You can come tell me. You can tell any one of people in the room that you'll find with a lanyard around their neck. They are our prayer team. They are our prayer deputized ambassadors, and they would love to pray with you and put a Bible in your hands and just welcome you to Team Jesus. It's a decision you will not regret, and just tell somebody. Number two, dive in. And that means get growing in God. I think the best way that you can start growing God, two things. Get a Bible so you can start reading it, and we'll give you one today if you don't have one. And number two, come back next week. Just start showing up. Just start showing up, and the relationships you'll make with people in this room will transform your life, as will reading God's word. And then finally, number three, join up. What we mean by that is you're part of God's family. You don't have to do this on your own. And so we lock arm in arm. We grow together in God. God's got a place for you here at Citizen Heights. And if you don't live here, go home and find a local church that believes in the Bible, worships Jesus, and is committed to you, and become part of that. And the way you can do that is join a citizen group here. We have small groups that meet. We got a new semester kicking off in a few weeks. Get into a small group. We believe you grow best in the context of small groups, and we'd love to see you there. Three pro tips, but if you could have me choose any of them, I'd say get a Bible today and come back next week, and that would be enough. Sound good? Let's hear it again one more time for those who prayed that prayer. So many in the room. Off to an exciting song. I'm going to invite you to stand to your feet. We're going to do one more song, get you on your way. Are you in the Christmas spirit a little bit more? I hope so. Thank you for spending Christmas with us. We've got a great full schedule for the rest of December that you can be a part of. So we hope to see your face throughout December, as long as you're not traveling. But if you are traveling, you can join us online, and it's a special thing. Amen? All right.
Now for our cookie reception and photos with Santa downstairs. We can't wait to see you next week.